From him, through him, and to him are all things. To God be the glory. His word endures from beginning to end. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Greater is the one who lives in me. Greater is the love of Jesus. Greater than my sin. Greater than the grave. Above all other thrones. Above all other names. That is what you are, worthy King over my heart. There is none like you, there's no one else. Mercy, that is what I need, mercy. With every breath I breathe, where would I be now all by myself? You are the waterfall.
your love. You are the water for my soul. You are the hills that won't let go. You are the calm within my storm. You are the love that will endure. You are the victor in the fight. Over the darkness, you're the light. You are the hope I'm hanging.
I was thinking about today's call to worship, and the thought that came to mind was the story of Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve, as you are probably familiar with, they were created as perfect. They had no spiritual flaws, no emotional issues, no trauma, no drama. And everything around them that was created by God was perfect. Everything was as He intended. And they're literally living in a garden with God, face to face with Him. And the reason I mention that is because if you think about it, the perfection that of that creation from the very beginning, it included, by design, a dependence on God. It includes a perfect relationship with God that required, and it still requires, a devotion and a dependence on God. That is God's design for us to be dependent on Him. That's perfect. So today we're going to get up together and we're going to worship our God and King. And I'm going to read from Psalm 54, but we're going to use that to remind us and to assure every single one of us here today, everyone who's listening to us and gathering with us online, His beloved and His needy sisters and brothers, that God is our helper. God is the upholder of our lives. Together, I'm going to ask you all to please stand up. We're going to bring a sacrifice of praise to our Redeemer, to our friend, to our God, who is good and kind, loving and faithful. Psalm chapter 54, verse 6 and 7 says this: I will sacrifice a free will offering to you. I will praise your name, Lord, because it's good. For He has rescued me from every trouble, and my eye has looked down on my enemies. Let's worship together.
Mm-hmm. unto Jesus.
Come unto Jesus, all you are. Come to the mercy seat fervently. Here, bring your wounded heart, broken and needy. Come unto Jesus, mighty to hear. Joy of a comfortless light for the stream. Hope of the penitent, peace in our strife. Here speaks the Comforter tenderly saying, my yoke is easy, my burden is light. Come unto Jesus, come unto Jesus. Lay down your burdens, He is enough. Come unto Jesus, rest in His love.
Come taste the bread of life.
Broken for sins, drink from the cup of His promise made sure. Feast at His table as sons and as daughters. Grace overflowing is yours evermore. Come unto Jesus, come unto Jesus. Nothing but loss. Trade all this world for His kingdom unfading. Come unto Jesus, take up your cross. Come unto Jesus, take up your cross. Life everlasting He offers to
everyone to go ahead and have a seat right now. We have a rhythm, part of our liturgy here at Sunset Church is to every second and fourth week spend a moment that we're calling a missions moment to talk about, share with you, remind you of the different local and global partner organizations, or on the fourth weeks we're going to be focusing on a different missionary unit, missionaries that we sponsor and support. Now, the biggest thing for us as a church is we really want to focus on identifying advocates from within our church community that can stand up and share with you about our local partners. Today, that partner that we want to share about is City Impact, and the advocate for them, and this is where I'm going to ask the band to go ahead, and you guys can stop, you all can stop playing and step down so that you get to enjoy this as well. The advocate is sharing all the way from Singapore. It's my wife. So, you know, she can't, oh, actually, no, clap. She can hear you. She's going to watch the video. Shirley, can you show the video?
Hi, everyone. I'm Suzette, here to share a bit about City Impact and specifically its Impact Dash program, formerly known as Adopt a Building, that serves residents and the unhoused in the Tenderloin neighborhood of San Francisco. As part of this ministry, volunteers regularly visit the residents in the SROs or single residency occupancy buildings in the Tenderloin. Their mission of going to every floor, every door, to intervene through building relationships that will lead people to life transformation through knowing Jesus, is aligned with Sunset's mission of existing to glorify God by making gospel-transformed disciples of all people in our city and in the world. People who join these home visit teams get the amazing privilege to serve God and minister to residents by getting to know them, caring for them, sharing life with them, and, as opportunities come up naturally, telling them about how Jesus has impacted their own lives. Sunset has been involved in this work since 2015, when we started visiting residents at the Iroquois on O'Farrell Street at the edge of the Tenderloin. A core team of us, including children, went once a month after Sunday service, others joined when they could, and we befriended tenants who lived in the 74-unit, six-floor building. We would pray for each of them by name between visits. Rob and Shirley Kwan and their community group, Fellowship of the Ooks, led Christmas caroling there with their ukuleles a few times. And over the next few years, Sunset formed more teams to adopt or visit a couple of other buildings regularly. The pandemic interrupted that rhythm of sending regular teams, though a few individuals, including Grace and Will Kwan, have resumed going back to the Iroquois to see their friends. I personally witnessed how blessed and overjoyed the residents were to see them. We'd like to back them up and return as a church to rekindle and foster this partnership that Sunset has with City Impact. I personally love City Impact and the Impact Dash, or when I was involved, the Adopt a Building ministry. Participating in these home visits and building relationships with people I may not have otherwise met has been a pivotal part of my faith journey and opened my eyes and heart to the marginalized, overlooked, and vulnerable. Through hearing stories of trauma, isolation, fear, as well as blessings, I'm seeing how we really are all made in the image of God, worthy of dignity and love, as Christ loves us and came to visit us. Will you be the hands and feet of Jesus in the Tenderloin? Thank you for listening.
Partners. So if you could, the two prayer requests I want to lift up is this, that God will continue to use volunteers to care for and love those who are vulnerable in trouble, especially in the buildings that they're supporting. The second prayer request is for us, that those of us who feel a passion for this might be bold enough to step up. You can talk to Suzette, you can talk to Will and Grace Kwan, and they will be able to connect you to be able to learn more about how you can get involved with the Adopt a Building program or with City Impact potentially in general. But so pray for the ones that we are caring for and pray for us that we might care. And then I'll close this out and ask Nate to come up. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you so much for giving us this church the opportunity to partner with City Impact. For nearly a decade, we as a church have been trying to support them in the work that they're doing for those who are vulnerable, those who are destitute, those who are hurting. And I pray that that work will continue and that we will obey the call that you've made to us to do the good works that you have laid before us. In the name of your Son, Christ, I pray. Amen. Nate?
Morning, church. God is good. All the time. All right. Some of you guys are catching on. That's good. We're going to be moving into community time in a moment. We have so much to be thankful for. You know, we're in God's house this morning. I know many of you are looking forward a little later. There's a Taylor Swift documentary about her going to a football game. Hope you guys enjoy that. Let's take a moment. Let's stand up, greet each other in the Lord, and then we'll go through some announcements. All right. Everyone's excited, it appears. I can feel the buzz, Abe. I can feel the excitement for later. My name is Nathan Taylor. I am a member here at Sunset. I teach from time to time at the Children's Church. I'd like to welcome anybody who's a newcomer. I'd like to welcome you and with a gift that we have at the lobby. So after service, please go down and let us give you a little gift from us at the welcome desk. Our vision: we exist to glorify God by making gospel-transformed disciples of all people in our city and in the world. Some of the ways that we're going to exemplify that is in the upcoming announcement. We have a baptism coming up, something to be really excited about. It's scheduled for Sunday, the first Sunday of March, the 3rd at 11 a.m. You can still sign up. If you know someone that wants to get baptized, if you have a child or a youth that is interested, please have them sign up online at the events page by February 22nd, and we can celebrate the baptisms together and welcoming new family into the house of God. We also have a coffee for a cause today. As mentioned earlier by Suzette, we're going to be supporting City Impact today. So after service, please head down and buy yourself a treat and support the cause. We'll be moving into just focusing on giving an offering of our time, and I'd like to just quickly pray for us as we prepare our hearts for that and for the message. Father in heaven, you are so good. Lord, we are just so blessed to be your children. And Lord, everything that we have, every single thing that we have is a gift from you. Whether it's the jobs that we have, the house that we live in, the family that we have, Lord, you are the great provider. And I pray that we never forget that all that we have comes from you. So as we give our offering to you, Lord, as we give our tithe, as we give of our time, help us to never forget that it's not us who did all this. It's not us who got that promotion or got all that money or got the house. Lord, it's you. So as we give back, I pray that we are humble when giving back to recognize how great and generous and how wonderful you are. Thank you, Father, for always providing for us now and in times to come. In your holy, precious name, amen. We're going to be a little efficient today. I'm going to read the word too. All right, so today's scripture is Job 5, and I'm going to be reading verses 15 through 17, if you can follow along with me. But he saves the needy from the sword of their mouth and from the hand of the mighty. So the poor have hope, and the injustice shuts her mouth. Behold, Blessed is the one whom God reproves. Therefore, despise not the disciple of the Almighty. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you very much, Nate. And we were very efficient. It's funny, I did not know today is Super Bowl Sunday. I'm really sorry. We have very few references to Super Bowl. Sorry about that. This is how much I don't watch sports. Anyway, welcome to Sunset Church. My name is Abe, and I have the joy of serving as one of the pastors here at this church. Now, if you're joining us for the first time today, let me mention this. We have been spending and will be spending the next few months looking at the book of Job. Okay, Pastor Joey, he kicked it off in early January, and more than a few folks have already come up and commented how they've appreciated the messages that have been shared to date. And if you haven't had a chance, I suggest go ahead, go online. We have a Vimeo channel, we have a YouTube channel, we have podcasts. You can get to all of them through our website. If you just go to the past sermons option in the menu, just tap there. I'm not going to do a full recap of what Pastor Joy has already preached up until now, but I do want to mention one thing to give some context. Now, Pastor Joy and I, as well as the elders, we talked about this, and listen, we truly believe that spending time focusing on the book of Job, it's going to allow us to be more than a church that just, you know, is all happy, happy, joy, joy. That's not, we absolutely want to be a church. We want to have folks here to be inspired. We want the community here to experience the joy of Christ as we all strive to be gospel transformed. But Sunset Church also wants to, Sunset Church needs to be a place where we do not ignore difficulty. We need to be a place where we do not ignore trauma, where we do not ignore sorrow, where we do not ignore suffering, especially innocent suffering. And that's what unpacking the book of Job is bringing us. But before I get into the message in itself, if you would, will you pray with me? I want to pray before we get started. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for the opportunity that you have given each and every one of us here. We are so in need of you, of your grace and your love and your mercy. I pray that now as we come before you, allow us to truly dwell in your presence now. And God, I beg you, let the words that come out of my mouth be not mine, but yours alone. In the name of your Son, Christ, I pray. Amen. So I want to share a little bit of how we, as they say, make the sausage. I want to give you a little behind the scenes of each Sunday service. Now, every week, every service that we have, there are a lot of different people, a lot of different teams involved in this service. So, and every single person that is involved is essential to creating what we call a liturgy. Now, liturgy is basically the order of service, a liturgy that intends to draw everyone in our community closer to God, okay? The different teams, they are designed, they're intended to help create this environment that allows us to sit in God's presence, that allows us to draw nearer to God. And we have the production crew up there, we have the hospitality team, we have the CFC team, we're freshmen's team, we have the worship team, and we have the pastor team, which I'm a part of, right? And now we have a new team that we've labeled Team Lit. They have their own little fire emoji as well. Because now, let me explain, Team Lit stands for our liturgy or our liturgical team. So Team Lit are all the folks that help us complete the different parts of our service. We have our MCs, like Nate. We have our mission moment advocate, like my wife, Suzette. We have our scripture readers. It was supposed to be Jason, but there's issues right now. But anyway, they're all part of this team we call Team Lit. Which is, I think, appropriate. You know, I think my wife is pretty lit, so that's good. By the way, if you're older and you don't know, lit means amazing, just as FYI. We are a church, by the way, that absolutely wants everyone to be involved, from the major things to the minor things, because I like to say community is not something you find. Community is something you build. And so we want to be a body of Christ that's not consumeristic in mindset, but we want to be a body that's building together a community. So if you're not involved in some form or fashion, I'm going to ask you, come chat with me, email me, talk to me. Find ways to get involved as a part of this community that we're building. But anyway, part of my job as the pastor, on the pastor team, I need to provide content, some information, to support all the teams, especially Team Lit, right? And so I did that. And I wrote, sent out the notes. I included today's passage so that they can have it on our video. Today's title message. I'm calling it Miserable Comforters, and you'll see why in a second. I included the scripture reading. I also included the passage that today's sermon is going to cover, and that's chapters 4 to 27. There's 23 chapters. It's a lot. It's 80% of the book of Job. And someone did message me, and they wanted to be sure that I did not make a typo, because maybe I wanted someone to read Job chapter 4, verse 27, which would not be possible because Job 4 only has 21 verses. But those notes were correct. We are covering chapter 4 to chapter 27. And I'm going to say this. Don't worry about it. I like to keep my messages short, first of all. And if you've been using one of the reading plans that I emailed out, or maybe your community group is actually diving deep into the book of Job, or maybe you're just someone who really likes the book of Job and you've read it a few times, you know that basically Job's, his three friends, they went from being pretty amazing people in chapter 2 to becoming pretty horrible, starting in chapter 4 and going on to the end. And as you read through chapter 4 to chapter 27, you see this trio, they're teaching us in vivid detail how to be horrible friends. I like Job's words. In chapter 16, verse 2, he says, "Miserable comforters are y'all." So chapter 4 to 27, basically it's a discussion, it's a debate between these miserable comforters and Job. Now next week, Chris is going to be preaching on Job's response. But today, what I want to do is I want to look at the words of these miserable comforters. And I want to learn, hopefully, what not to say. And let me start by just simply summarizing these 23 chapters from the part of the three terrible friends. These 23 chapters basically are this. They're saying Job's suffering, Job's fault. All the stuff that's happening to Job is because Job must have done something wrong. And that's it. That's the 23 chapters. For 23 chapters, Job's three friends, Eliphaz, Zophar, Bildad, 23 chapters of his quote-unquote friends basically telling Job, all this suffering is because of you. You did something wrong. But then if you turn to Job chapter 42, verse 7, God tells Eliphaz this, "My anger burns against you and against your two friends, for you have not spoken of me what is right, as my servant Job has." So not only were these three friends miserable comforters, they were also misrepresenting God. So like I said, I'm going to take some time today to look at what we can do to avoid going down the same path that Eliphaz, Zophar, and Bildad did, how we can avoid becoming miserable comforters. Right? And as I was preparing for today's message, I was really racking my brain. I was trying to think of examples of friends like Eliphaz, Zophar, and Bildad in my life. Now, 10 years ago, previous life, I used to work as a director of product for a startup company, a mobile app company. The one of the co-founders is a friend of mine. He brought me in. I did that for a few years. And anyway, I remember the day that he called me up and he said, "I need you to start putting your resume together." I was getting laid off. There's a long story around that and how everything that happened that's not relevant, but there's two things that are relevant that I want to share with you. One, I totally remember how I felt when I got that phone call. And I was freaking out because it had been decades since I'd had to look for a job. I didn't know how to put a resume together anymore. So I was just scared out of my mind. The other thing that's relevant and that I remember is this. It's the words of my Eliphaz, Zophar, and Bildad. What that person said to me was this. "Everything happens for a reason. Shut up. such a miserable comforter you are. A few weeks ago, Pastor Joey, he was excitedly going on to cheer his beloved Detroit Lions. If you're not aware, as I just learned today, today's Super Bowl, and they lost. The Lions lost to San Francisco. And I still think the words of his Eliphaz, Zophar, and Bildad are ringing in him. And the words were, "I'm so glad the 49ers won." Miserable comforter that you are. I want you to take a moment right now from your seat. Think of a miserable comforter in your own life. If you can't think of a someone, think of what they said. Something that was said. And if you can't think of that, maybe you were the miserable comforter in someone else's life. Maybe you failed to read the room. Maybe you failed and you said something unhelpful. You know, I think it's safe to assume that each of us here can probably think of at least one example of one or the other. In the book of Job, it shows us that we're not alone. You have company being the subject of, or maybe just being, the miserable comforter. It's been the reality on earth for a long time. And there's a lot of things that we can learn in these 23 chapters about what not to do. How we can learn how to avoid becoming miserable comforters. But I'm just going to focus on a few today. And the very first one I want to focus on this is this. Stop assuming. There's this old adage, many of you may be familiar with it. It says, basically, don't assume, because when you assume, you make a A-S-S, donkey, of you and M-E, me. And these three definitely make bad assumptions. These three are definitely some donkeys. Because all three assumed that Job was hiding some deep, dark, secret sin, and he just needed to confess, and then everything would be great, copacetic. But in Job chapter 22, verse 5, Eliphaz, is this what he says to him? Is not your evil abundant? There's no end to your iniquities. But we get some behind the scenes. We see in the very first chapter that the suffering that Job was going through had nothing to do with him, or at least nothing to do with anything he specifically did. Actually, he was blameless and upright. Job chapter 1, verse 8 says very specifically, "And the Lord said to Satan, 'Have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil?'" See, their assumption, it was based on an incomplete understanding of Scripture, and it was based on an incomplete understanding of the situation that Job was in. You know, as I was studying this, if you look at Galatians chapter 6, verse 7, this is what it says. It says, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever one sows, that will he also reap." In Psalm chapter 37, verse 9, it says there, "For the evildoers shall be cut off, but those who wait for the Lord shall inherit the land." And if you read these, you're like, what Eliphaz wrote, it doesn't actually seem very far off. But he was working with incomplete information, and it resulted in a bad assumption, right? Because you know, we have to consider the context of any scripture we read, and we do it by looking at the entirety of scripture. And if we consider the entirety of scripture, then we can understand that gospel-transformed living, it means that we need to look at the long game, not immediate gain. See, what one sows, one will absolutely reap. Evildoers will be cut off, yes. But when? When this will happen is not something that's according to our will. It is absolutely according to God's wisdom. Looking at the entirety of Scripture, you see example after example after example of God's redemption timing being based on Him, not on you and me. Because you have evil kings in Israel. They would reign for decades. You have evil people prospering. In Revelation, you have these martyrs in heaven. They're waiting and saying, "God, how long until we're vindicated?" Yes. Yes. What one sows, one will reap. Evil shall be cut off. But for a lot of folks, that day is not going to come until the day of judgment. And not only can one, make a bad assumption based on an incomplete understanding of Scripture, but you can also make a bad assumption based on an incomplete understanding of a situation. Because sometimes, the suffering that the person near you is going through, it's not something that they've sown. Sometimes, just like Job, it's truly innocent suffering that's causing it. So these miserable comforters, they assumed incorrectly that because so much bad was happening to Job, that he must have done something wrong. And so he had to do the one thing that he must do, which is repent. And here's the thing. At the heart of this concept is this. There's an incorrect understanding of what gospel transformation is intended to be. See, for these miserable comforters, for them, faith in God is transactional. If I obey, God will reward. Obedience is the price I pay to have a blessed life. In other words, they didn't desire God out of a desire for God. They desired God for what God could provide to them. So the first lesson I think we can take away from these miserable comforters is this. Stop assuming. Stop assuming a transactional faith. Instead, we need to start seeking a transformational relationship with our Father in heaven. In order for us to stop assuming a transactional faith, though, and to move to living a transformational relationship, first of all, we need to actually stop living a transactional faith. We need to start building a transformed relationship with God. And so what I want to do is I want to get practical for just a moment before we move on to the second one. And this is potentially going to be a little uncomfortable as we consider what that might mean for each of us, including me. I want you to consider why y'all are sitting here right now. Or maybe, if you're online, why you're not sitting here right now. For those of you who are you here right now because you're a big fan of Jacob and wanted to watch him play? Are you here because you're hoping your kids will learn to chill out at Sunday school? Are you here because you're looking for a significant other? Good luck with that. Are you here because you want to earn some heaven bucks, get some points in heaven? Or are you here because of a true desire to grow closer to God, to not neglect gathering together as is the habit of some? Are you here because you understand that because of your desire to draw nearer to our God in heaven, you want to also be near your fellow image bearers of God? You want to encourage and you want to be encouraged. Don't misunderstand me. No shame, no shade on anyone for why you're here. I'm glad, we are glad that you're here regardless of why you've come. But I want to say that as we seek to become a community of gospel-transformed disciples, I'm going to ask that we stop assuming and stop living a transactional faith and start considering living a transformational relationship with the Lord of Lords and with the King of Kings. That's the first one. The second lesson that I think that we can learn from this passage is from is this. Stop blaming the victim. Job chapter 15, verse 4. Eliphaz accuses Job of a few things. He says this, "But you are doing away with the fear of God and hindering meditation before God." And let me explain. Basically, Eliphaz is proclaiming that Job is constantly saying that his suffering is not because of anything he's done. If Job keeps saying that, and if it's true, then Job is going to basically destroy the church. That's his proclamation, Eliphaz. No one's going to pray anymore. No one's going to bother going to community group anymore. No one's going to bother serving with City Impact and Adopt a Building. No one's going to bother teaching Sunday school. There's no need for Sunday school. The Christian world will implode. And I'd have to retire again and find something else to do. Because if transactional faith is not real, if a tit-for-tat theology is not the truth, Eliphaz is saying, what's the use of God? And that will not fly with Eliphaz. He can't live with that being a possibility. So to make sure that Eliphaz's reality remains intact, it has to be Job's fault. It's got to be his fault. Eliphaz has to blame Job for the suffering. Job, because if he doesn't blame Job, if it's not Job's fault that all this is happening to him, then it could happen to Eliphaz too. I want to suggest this. I want to say my belief is this. Blaming the victim is about protecting me. See, blaming the victim is about finding the fault in the other person so that I can look at myself and think, oh, at least I'm not like that. I mean, the dude, Eliphaz, went so far as to make up allegations about Job, against Job. Job had to be doing something bad for so much bad stuff to happen to him. In Job chapter 22, verse 5 to 9, this is what he wrote. He said, is not your evil abundant? There's no end to your iniquities. For you have exacted pledges of your brothers for nothing and stripped the naked of their clothing. You've given no water to the weary to drink, and you've withheld bread from the hungry. The man with power possessed the land, and the favored man lived in it, and you have sent widows away empty, and the arms of the fatherless were crushed. See, if blaming the victim is about me, it's about protecting me, it's about being self-centered, then I think the solution, the way to not be a miserable comforter, can be found in Philippians chapter 2, verse 3. Says this, do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility, count others more significant than yourselves. See, we stop blaming the victim by loving the victim. We stop blaming the victim by not looking for reasons for their suffering. In Romans chapter 12, verse 10, it tells us that we're to love each other deeply as sisters and brothers. We stop blaming the victim by no longer violating God's original design from the beginning, from creation. We stop blaming the victim by no longer ignoring God's intention for those who are created in his image to be in relationship with each other and with him. Back in the 1990s, I was working in Chicago as a social worker, and AIDS was becoming a bigger thing, especially in the Asian American community over in Chicago. There was an organization that I used to volunteer with, help out, partner with, and they would do HIV testing, especially amongst Asian Americans. It was an Asian American organization. Anyway, anytime somebody was asked to return to get the results from their HIV test, they were always asked, do not come alone. Bring somebody you trust. And sometimes the folks would come back with no one. No one that they could trust. So this organization, they would step up. They would step up and bring a volunteer in those moments. Someone who showed no judgment. Someone who did not blame. Someone who just loved. So as that person would receive their news, whether it was good or bad, that volunteer would celebrate with them or cry with them. See, the thing is, we each bear God's image, right? And we are called to love one another deeply as sisters and as brothers, because this is how we consider others more significant. This is how we stop blaming the victim. This is how we avoid becoming miserable comforters. I'm actually going to start wrapping up so you have more time to eat stuff downstairs. I want to end with one last lesson. And just to summarize, let me say, we avoid becoming miserable comforters by, one, stop assuming a transactional faith, and two, by stop blaming the victim, stopping to blame the victim. The last thing, and I think this is something that can be like an umbrella over the first two that I just mentioned, which is this, check your theology. So I want to read just the last verse of the passage that was read today from Job. Job chapter 5, verse 17 says this, behold, blessed is the one whom God reproves. Therefore, despise not the discipline of the Almighty. Now, I'll tell you, if I'm being very, very honest, and if I did not have the context of the entirety of Scripture, I would read this verse from Eliphaz and think, oh, you know, that sounds about right. Actually, in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 11 and 12, it says something very similar. It says, my son, do not despise the Lord's discipline or be weary of his reproof, for the Lord reproves the one whom he loves, as a father the son in whom he delights. There's something you can see when you read through these 23 chapters. See, our miserable comforters, you can see their theology. And I would sum up their theology like this. They believe God has absolute control over everything. Agree. They also believe God is absolutely fair and just. Yes, absolutely. Therefore, God will always punish the wicked and bless the righteous now. And if you're suffering, you've sinned. You're just being punished. And this is where I think we have to take the lesson that the author of Job is trying to show us. We need to check our theology regularly. Because, yeah, God has absolute power and control over everything. Agreed. And, yes, God is absolutely fair. God is absolutely just. And, yes, we can say with confidence that our absolutely fair and absolutely just God will absolutely punish the wicked and bless the righteous one day. But thank God for 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, says this. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. See, the bad theology of our miserable comforters is that God's promise is based on my timeline. But that's wrong. God's promise is based on his timeline. It's based on the timeline of a patient and loving father who does not want anyone to perish, who does not want anyone to be separated from him. God will punish the wicked on the day he decides, on the day of his judgment. We cannot ignore, we cannot forget the fact that God is giving each and every one of us every opportunity for his called and for his chosen to recognize and to repent. The other part of the miserable comforter's theology that is a bit sus, and sus means suspect, by the way, the miserable comforter's sus theology is this idea that suffering is only ever a result of sin. And if that were truly the case, then the devil has no role to play. So even though Eliphaz, Zophar, Bildad, they didn't have access, they didn't have the behind the scenes of that heavenly courtroom drama that happened in chapters 1 and 2, so they don't have all that, but they still understand, and they are fully aware of the devil. Job references Leviathan. He references the serpent throughout the book. So there is an understanding of the spiritual realm, right? That's true within antiquity. But bad theology forgets that the devil is working hard. The devil is working hard against us constantly. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12 reminds us of this too. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. So we avoid becoming miserable comforters by checking our theology. And I'll tell you, actually, Job chapter 1, verse 21, it's a really good starting point. His theology there is, says this, naked I came from my mother's womb, naked shall I return. The Lord gave, the Lord has taken away, blessed be the name of the Lord. And in God's absolute control and in God's absolute justice, he is one day going to redeem, he's going to bring his chosen home. We can count on that. But in the meantime, today, we are wrestling with a cosmic darkness, with a spiritual force that wants to kill us. But God's still in control. God's justice is still absolute. Now, I'll tell you, practically speaking, though, checking our theology, it will consider all the things that we just talked about already. But on top of that, I want to suggest that sometimes checking our theology, it means checking, like checking in your luggage on a plane, checking our theology, holding back for a minute, sharing your theology. Now, I mentioned that Job, his friends, they started off really well. In chapter 2, verse 13, I love this. It says, and they sat with him on the ground 7 days and 7 nights, and no one spoke a word to him, for they saw that his suffering was great. Not a word for a week. They just wept with him. You see something similar in Romans chapter 12, verse 15. It says this, rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep. But then Job, he started talking. And Eliphaz, Zophar, Bildad, these miserable comforters became who they were. Because they had to open their mouths too. See, here's the reality we live in. People in pain sometimes say things they may not mean. People in pain sometimes say things that might be theologically questionable. People in pain sometimes say things, there is such a deep trauma within them. Sometimes things need to come out. So in those moments, I'm just going to ask you, please check your theology. Hold it back. And just hurt with those who are hurting. Not everything has to become a life lesson. Sometimes you just need to sit. You just need to listen. Sometimes you just need to weep. Just for a minute. I want to end here. I want to encourage you to consider not being miserable comforters. Hopefully you don't want to be one. I want you to stop assuming a transactional faith by living a transformational relationship with God. I want you to stop blaming the victim by loving the victim. And I want you to check your theology while you check your theology. Okay? Why don't we pray as the band comes up? Will you pray with me? Father, you are good. You are absolutely in control. You are absolutely holy. You are absolutely just. And the things that might be happening in the lives of our friends and our family or ourselves, we may not understand them, but you do. So I ask you, allow each and every one of us here to be able to see your glory. Find peace in your glory. Find peace and shalom in you, God. Allow each and every one of us to be able to be an encouragement to those around us who might be suffering. In the name of your Son, Christ, I pray. Amen.
Yeah.
next few moments, take some time to consider Jesus as our Redeemer, as our rock and as our hope in the midst of whatever storms we're facing in our lives.
My salvation.
close with a benediction. And now may the peace of our Heavenly Father, and may the grace of the Son of God, may the fellowship of the Holy Spirit bless and keep each and every one of us, God. May our lives bring you, God, all the glory. May our lives bring you all the majesty, for you have all dominion. You have all authority. You have all power before all time, now and forevermore. Amen. Downstairs, CFC, go.